Welcome to the business of bass. And this man is the best in the business. For more than two decades, Nathan East has earned the reputation among artists, producers, and fans as the best at what he does. He's toured and recorded with the top names in the business, legends like Eric Clapton.
Nathan is a team player. He is a virtuoso, and yet he can provide the support.
Phil Collins.
Nathan can play any style of music. I mean, I've never had to sit down really and say, this is what I want. You know, he hears it and he just knows.
Quincy Jones.
Nate is a singular bass player. Tremendous sensitivity.
Lionel Richie.
I will say some days, that's good for me. And Nathan and the boys will say, give us one more. That's not our best.
And Billy Preston.
He knows when to put the licks in, when not to. It's an art to that, and it's great to play with a bass player that does it, like Nathan.
The business of bass.
Whether it's pop or rock, jazz or hip-hop, Nathan East is at the top of every producer's call list for the foundation that he and his signature Yamaha bass brings to the music that the world and America loves and listens to. So Nathan, the bass guitar's been pretty good to you.
I'd say it's been very good to me, and I've had a chance to travel the world over many, many times and meet and play with and learn from some of my favorite musicians. I mean, it's just been an experience and a ride that I can't imagine anything else.
Oh, you played with so many people. And now you get a chance to do this video.
Via this video, I'd like to introduce a very intuitive approach to playing the bass, and not just being a good bass player, but being an overall good musician. It's not just about the music, it's about the spirit and really the soul that you bring to the music.
Truly the essence of a player is all about their whole feel. So whether it's, you know, commercial music, contemporary music, or whether it's jazz or gospel or whatever it is, it's all about feel always.
Once a musician reaches a certain level, technical ability is a given. It's taste and feel where you find the real individual differences.
When you bring a musician in, you really don't want to say to him, this is what you play. You know, you really want him to sort of understand where you are with this particular piece of music and what is necessary.
Nathan is a pro, fantastic musician, plays with a lot of authority and a lot of feeling and emotion. He plays a song and he doesn't overplay.
Feel can be thought of as how in tune you are with the rest of the group, how well you understand what they're doing and where they're going. Taste is how you choose to make your musical contribution within that understanding. It's always been my approach to look for the simplest path.
The best cats don't need to prove anything.
It's not about being as fancy as you can. It's about being as tasteful.
It's wonderful when you can get a guy to kind of know when to give it up to the other person. And it's listening. It's really listening and respecting. The A players understand that.
You have to be aware of what everybody in the group is doing at all times. A common mistake beginning musicians make is to think they have to play as much as they can. The real secret is to know what your role is, when to step up, and when to lay back.
In all fields of music, there are people who play really well in their bedrooms, you know. But you put them in a unit and they don't know how to function. It's a question of being in harmony with what is actually taking place, not what in theory could take place.
When the group thing really came together for me, it was like a whole new world had opened up. Experience will teach you this. And I promise you, when the band is really working, you'll have your chance to shine.
like playing with other musicians better than I do playing solo. I enjoy the dialogue. I enjoy hearing what they're doing and how what I do fits into it.
And that's the exciting part, it's the dialogue. It raises my level of playing the guitar. They're gonna feed me information while they're reacting to what I'm playing that will make me play something I would have never chosen to play if I was there by myself. I'm as good as, and only as good as, the guys I'm playing with.
Because such a collaboration really isn't. I think the most divine creation is a collective one. If you can really burn by yourself, amen, great. But when you get that as a whole, that's when the divinity hits it. Everybody thinking about the same thing and feeling the same thing at the same time. It's an amazing balance of a lot of qualities.
Amazing things about your career has been all the range of styles of music that you've had a chance to perform over the years. So what would you say would be the secret to becoming a well-rounded musician?
Well, if I could sum it up in one word, it would be listen. Listen to everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, listen to all different styles of music and just get your hands on everything that you can listen to. The music of today is so diverse, and you have different combinations and styles being blended together, jazz, rock, pop, and there's kind of like this mixture. And so if you have listened and checked out different styles of music, most of the best musicians in the world today have that in their
repertoire. A huge range of music that they know and are familiar with.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, is there any way that we could have a chance to see actually what you're talking about? Well, we could listen to maybe some basic pop lines that every professional bassist should know.
Okay, well, let's just look at a couple of lines.
All right.
First of all, let's listen to this beat here. So I'm gonna listen to the drums.
And this is the pop.
Right, and I'll listen to the kick drum.
If you practice with a drum machine, it will really help lock in your time and rhythm. Listen closely to the kick and snare drum and try to create an interesting line. Try to make the bass line singable. If you think about it, many popular hits revolve around a strong and memorable bass line.
Okay, so how's that different than a rock line?
Okay, so that was
that's pop.
Kind of more pop-ish. Yeah. Right. Now, the rock would be maybe more of the eighth note feel, maybe stay on the same line. We're in the key of A.
Oh, right. Oh, I like that.
More driving.
Yeah.
One of the foundations of rock and roll is the driving bass line, which pushes the band. Create a strong pulse that supports the band rhythmically as well as melodically. Eighth note repetition is a good starting point. Experiment with different variations and combinations of notes.
Oh, that's cool. All right, so how is that different than, let's say, a jazz line?
So jazz is a little more of a, let's say, a walking type feel. So with this same kind of beat, I would just add a walking feel. So say we're in the key of A again.
Okay.
One, two, three, four.
I think that's my favorite.
Walking bass line allows you to take advantage of the full range of the bass. You lead the band through the chord changes with your selection of passing notes, scales, and arpeggios. Think in terms of swinging the band and giving the bass line some life. Skip around as if you are dancing on the bass. Try to give each note character.
Oh yeah, I like that. What about funk? What about funk?
Okay, so funk, we'll stay in the key of A, so.
Oh yeah, I like that. Oh yeah, that makes me want to dance.
Uh-huh. You know, just a little more popping.
Oh yeah, this is it. This is it. This is my favorite.
Yeah. Thought jazz was.
No, this is it. This is it. This is it for me. Oh yeah, this makes me want to dance for sure.
Slapping and popping styles were developed in situations where no drummer was present. In funk, the percussive contribution of the bass becomes as important as its melodic contribution. Think of the bass as a drum and create drum grooves and patterns by slapping with the right hand and hammering the strings with the fingers of the left.
Oh, yeah. So, Nate, you described the rhythm section, the bass and the drums, as basically the foundation of the music. So how does the bass guitar and the drummer actually work together?
We kind of feed off of each other, but I listen to his kick drum, and I listen to his snare and his hi-hat, and I listen to where he puts the beat. He could put it on top of the beat, in front, right in the middle, behind, a little behind. So I have to kind of really zone into what he's doing. Focus on that, then we just do what we call infectious grooves, you know, and we try to just make it feel really good, and then everyone else can add to that.
And he's gonna listen to you too, because you guys are a team, right? You work together.
Yeah, we are definitely married.
Okay.
Am I good?
Perfect.
The contemporary jazz band 4Play is a group I've enjoyed playing with since we first got together in 1990, and for three very good reasons. Bob James on keyboards, Larry Carlton on guitar, and my friend of over 20 years, Harvey Mason on drums.
Nate's solid as a rock, and I've come to expect so much from his chair that I don't worry about it, I don't think about it. I trust Nathan, and trust and respect is so much a part of it. And once someone has attained a certain level of playing, then you have this mutual give and take. And that's where the beauty of a bass player and a drummer are together.
We don't verbally express it, but we do know when we are in that zone.
It's just a feeling. This is it. We're on the right track now. You can just tell. I hear every single note Nathan plays. I know right where every note is moved, is placed in relation to where I'm playing, and I just can hear it. He can play one little pluck. One little beat moved just one way or the other will cause reaction and cause me, I know. That's just like talking.
It's a constant state of analysis, I would say, that I'm always listening to what he's doing, and if he shifts and goes into fifth gear, I gotta be there with him. Can't leave him out there on his own, you know? And we...
yeah, we talk about that, yeah.
Because that's happened too, where, you know, it's like he's trying to get you going. You gotta listen.
Nate sucked up to me. He says, yeah, Mace, you stayed home for me, man. Thanks. He says, you stayed home for me. You were chopping wood. Sometimes it gets to the point where I've gotta stay home. You know, he may have a difficult part, or he has a part that's really he has to sort of do his thing. So it's my job to kind of keep him honest.
If I'm a little busier in that particular passage, then Harvey, maybe he's not going to be so busy. You know? If he's going out there and stretching a little bit, I'm going to sit down there and just hold down the bottom. There's a lot of very intricate dialogue that goes on that at the end result is it just feeling good.
You can't teach it per se. It's something that you gain through experience and just musicality, and then it just has to happen, then you have to trust it and deal with it.
Trust is very important in playing with other musicians.
The equation is pretty straightforward. If you trust the musicians around you, you will be more comfortable with experimentation, and experimentation is what leads to musical growth. For over a decade, the other members of 4Play have provided me with a priceless opportunity to grow as a musician in the company of some genuinely world-class players. I only hope I've given as much back. Practice is a very important thing because repetition is the mother of success. Mm. And if you do a certain act over and over again, you get better. You have to get better. So
now, you're one of the best in the business. Are you telling me you really need to practice?
Absolutely. Practice is one of those things that keeps you limber. It keeps your muscles trained. And basically, if I don't practice for a day or so, I can kind of tell that I haven't practiced. Of course, 2-3 days, then the guys in the band can tell. And any longer than that, a week or so, the audience can tell. And when they can tell, you know you're in trouble.
Just like staying in good shape physically, it's the same thing with music. The more you practice and the more you are in shape, the more possibilities that you have, the more power you have as a performer.
Your craft has to be second nature. Oscar Peterson would think about how to finger B scale. You know, that's second nature. All he has to do is feel, and whatever he feels will come out because his craft is rock bottom, and that's essential.
Now, what kinds of practice habits would a bass guitarist develop?
I work on different techniques. One to kind of keep the left hand warmed up is the left finger techniques with trills. And a trill is just basically going back and forth between two notes like that. So that's fair enough. You do that slowly, speed it up.
So is that help mostly with the left hand then?
That helps with the left hand. And then, so that worked the first two fingers. Now, if I want to work the next two fingers, I do it. It's a little more difficult. And then if you do it with the last two fingers, it's really difficult.
Yeah, it looks like it. What about working up and down the strings?
Well, yeah, basically I start, say, on the B flat, so I'm. My way up the neck and work my way across the fingerboard. And you'll know by the time you worked your way up and down the neck and across the fingerboard, you'll have to shake your hand out of
it. Yeah, I bet. Now, and do they get boring at all, these kind of exercises for you?
I have to admit, they're a little boring. You know? That's why if you do it in front of the TV or whatever, but it's just like anything else, you know. A great master at any occupation, profession has to practice to stay in shape.
And what about practicing with another person?
That's a good idea as well. You know, get somebody else that wants to practice and trade ideas back and forth and just kind of create exercises.
Probably makes the time go a lot faster and you can bounce
faster,
off each other.
Right.
And what about the right hand techniques?
Right hand is a similar thing. You know, I use the first two fingers.
Sure.
And I usually do an exercise that incorporates switching back and forth between the two fingers.
Okay.
And then what I do to make it challenging is speed it up until I can get it as fast as I can get it. And what that does, again, is it keeps the muscles lubricated.
So what do you think is more important, the right or the left hand?
They're both equally important. And I mean, it basically, once you incorporate the two, then you have what it takes to make good music. So basically, again, you know, I'm using the right hand and the left hand.
Right, so they're working together. Now, it's interesting because I notice a different sound when you're on you play close to the bridge, and then a different sound when you play close to the neck.
You have good ears.
Yeah, I got a good ear.
No, that's absolutely right. When you want a nice, warm, kind of a fat tone, I like to play closer to the neck so you get it.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
nice,
that's
pretty,
different.
You know, like for a ballad, for instance, if you're recording a ballad, you want it to be nice, fat, and round, you know. So I use that sound. And like you said, if we want to get closer to the bridge for a more percussive.
That's completely completely different than what you just played. It sounds.
Yeah.
And what about like snapping and popping?
Okay.
I love that.
Well, you know a lot about the bass, don't you?
I love that, though.
Well, actually, it's it's a style that's been around for years that every bass player pretty much does. And
see, that's the kind of stuff I like. Yeah.
Again, people kind of start slowly and speed it.
Now, what's amazing is that it can sound really loud and it can sound soft. And it seems like you have to have a good ear, especially when you're doing overdubs, right?
Well, this is very true. And actually, it's very important to use dynamics when you play. And most people say dynamics. I'm playing as loud as I can, you know. So.
Yeah.
But what you have to do is try to keep a consistent sound, so when you're overdubbing, if you go to punch in, the level should be the same.
It's not going
to
stand out.
Right, exactly.
Uh-huh.
And that's one of the most challenging things about overdubbing.
Right.
And, you know, overdubbing is, for instance, if you happen to make a mistake on a tracking date, you have to go back and fix the note. When you go back and play, you're going to want your notes to be at the same level that they were. So if you were doing a rock line, driving line like that, when I go back into overdub, I don't want it to be too soft or too loud, you know.
Mm-hmm. So once again, it's about listening too,
listening,
right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, everything that you're saying to me seems like practice is really important.
If you really want to make music your life, that encompasses everything. Mm-hmm. And you actually live it. And practicing is a part of that.
We're very happy to be here in Baden-Baden. It's a beautiful city. And we thank you for coming out and spending the evening with us. And we were just wondering if Baden-Baden likes to hear the blues this evening. Yeah. Would you like to hear Larry play the blues?
If music was only about sitting alone in your room and practicing, the world would be a much duller place. But stepping out of the practice room and into a group for the first time can be a little intimidating. I always suggest to beginning musicians that the blues is a good place to start. Four Plays guitarist Larry Carlton has spent much of his career exploring this music.
One of the reasons that I like the blues is because the harmonic format of the basic blues is so simple that it's a great opportunity to try to express something very important without the support of jazz chords, a symphony orchestra, a string pad. It's a very, very simple art form. And I enjoy the challenge of being able to play something meaningful in such a simple art form.
Music doesn't have to be complex to be satisfying. Playing the bass is as much a process of awareness as it is of skill. And this awareness must extend beyond what the drummer is doing. This can be a little overwhelming at first. That's the beauty of the blues for a young bass player.
There's a dialogue going on with the bassist when I'm playing the blues. It's not as extensive as when you're playing jazz, which has much more improvisation. There's more chords and more substitution of chords available in a jazz song. But in the blues, I was thinking about it today that if Nate's laying down a, he can stay on that for the whole 12-bar blues if he chooses to, and it would be appropriate. So I have to listen to what Nate's going to do on the bass when it comes time to change chords and see if he chooses to change chords. Because if he chooses not to, and if he stays on the root, and I change to this, then I don't need to put that note in my chord. So there's dialogue going on and decisions being made, but they're all very subtle, and again, in a very simple format.
Leading and following, suggesting and responding, all in real time. This is a learned skill for every musician to some degree. The blues is a musical form that allows you to stretch as much as you feel comfortable doing.
Thank you.
One of the most important decisions a musician has to make is what equipment to use. Bass players are different from horn players, who are different from keyboardists, and so on. It's really valuable to have a solid relationship with a dealer who understands the nuances of your particular instrument. For me, that person is Long Lee at the LA Bass Exchange, someone I've known and trusted for years.
How you doing, Long?
Hey, how you doing, Nate? Good to see you. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Well, you know, here at the LA Bass Exchange, some of the things that sets us apart from other stores is that essentially we just cater to bass players, from professional to beginner and everybody in between. I see you've got your own signature bass here, so tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, right here we do have a bass that I worked on a design with Yamaha.
Well, I noticed that it's a 5-string as opposed to a 4-string. Is there a reason why you chose a 5?
I chose a 5 because of the range. It allows me access to the lower notes, and that low B really gives me a wide range.
If you're stranded on a desert island, this would be your desert island bass.
This would be my desert island bass.
Wow. So I see that you've got a lot of knobs on this instrument. Can you tell us a little bit about what they do?
We'll start with the volume knob, which is very important. And actually, I like a single volume control instead of two because I can actually do my swells and those little tricks like that. This is our pickup selection knob.
Okay.
And so we have two pickups here. In the middle, we're listening to both. And if we want more of a kind of like an upright bass sound or warmer sound, we'll go to just this pickup. And then the back pickup is more percussive.
Much tighter and punchier.
A little tighter, a little punchier.
Right.
Now we go to these, which are basically bass, mid-range, and the treble. And we know we need the bass because without it,
no good.
A little thin.
Yeah.
But then,
yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
This is what we want.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about.
It's all about the bass, right?
Exactly.
Mid-range, that punch that we need when we're playing live. Without it, there's no mid.
Yeah, right? Kind of lifeless.
Yeah, but if we roll that in again, and then of course the treble, because we want that nice, crisp, clear sound.
That's really going to help you cut through in a situation.
Exactly.
Right.
And then, you know, also we have a little equalization in the instrument itself. So if you really want to get into more of a personalized sound, I turn the EQ on and we go from that to that. So, and everything in between.
Right. So it sounds like you've got a lot of power right there and a lot of versatility, because I'm assuming that there isn't just one sound for every situation.
Exactly.
Now, is there an approach that you have EQ-wise?
We just so happen to have a little box that we came up with.
I saw that. Let's take a look at that.
All right. This box is something that we've developed with Yamaha. It's called the NE1. It's an equalization box, basically. Okay. What we have here is the basic level, which I usually leave on 10. And then we have different positions for, we have shallow, deep, and flat. So flat, of course, is the unit is inactive. I like the deep position because I like a very deep sound. And on the frequency setting, we go from 1 to 10. I usually like to keep it on the 4 or the 10 o'clock position.
Well, so it's basically like buying Nathan's fingers.
Well, something like that, but we call it the magic box because I really love the sound. I have no idea what's in it, but it sounds great.
Well, we know it works because the sound you get on countless recordings is always very pure, very deep, very warm, and articulate. So, tell us a little bit about strings. How important are strings? I noticed that you've got round wounds as opposed to flats. Why is that?
I like the round wound sound. I've been using that for many years, and it gives me a lot of crispy articulation, you know, very bright.
Tell me this, how important is a direct box?
Well, the DI is something that goes between the bass and the recording consoles. And I actually carry my direct box around to each studio with me because I want a very consistent sound, because every studio has a different direct box. The one I chose is an Avalon U5. And it basically is a sound that I really enjoy, very punchy and crispy.
Well, one of the things I also see is you're using some pretty esoteric looking cables. Does it really make a difference?
Actually, you were the one that introduced me to these cables made by Tara Labs. We plugged this cable in and A-B'd it to the one that I have been using. Mm-hmm. And I found that this was very, very clear and just about 15, 20% sharper sound than what I was using. So we immediately stocked up on these.
Right.
There are two very different settings a professional musician has to be comfortable in: studio recording sessions and live performances. I love playing live. When you're on stage, there's a very special kind of energy that comes from knowing there's no turning back, no second takes. Sometimes the audience is only feet away from you, so you know immediately how they're responding to what you play. When everyone, including the audience, is in the groove, there's nothing else in life like it.
Now, Nathan, tell me, what's the difference between playing live and playing in